Many of people have no basis of their Christian life. All they just, every other person is going, they're also going. And when there are difficulties in the way, they turn back. And when there are enticements in the way, they are easily swayed. Pray this morning, Lord Jesus, I lay my hand on the plow. I will not go back. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. A loud amen. Our Father, my God, we thank you. We appreciate you for this morning. Thank you, Lord God, for this program. Thank you, Lord, for your love and concern towards us. You want us to start to begin with you. I want us to end our journey in there because you said, tear not little flaw, for in my Father's house I've prepared mansion for you. Ultimately, what you desire is that we should finish well and then inherit eternal life. Lord Jesus, we are praying, we are asking this morning that as we share together, and all that we'll be sharing in this program, Lord Jesus will actually further establish the conviction of Christ in our heart in Jesus' name. Almighty God, we pray that as many who are doubting Thomas's, as many who have no basis of their Christian life, I pray this morning you will establish them. As many who are just follow, as many who are just going along like Judas Iscariot, no condition of their own, no reason why they are following, I pray this morning you will open their eyes. And Lord, they will follow. As Lord, those who know where they are going, in Jesus' name, they will be fully persuaded. Lord Jesus, Paul said, I know whom I believe. I pray, Lord, this morning, every one of these your children will know what they have believed and why they believe it, in Jesus' name. Speak to us as we share together now. Lord Jesus, we are praying. There are going to so much do in our lives. Lord Jesus, what will carry us through unto the end in Jesus' name. Oh, you told Elijah, you say, eat much. Eat well, because the journey is far. Oh, that will take us through the journey of life. Lord, we pray that in this program, you will impart into our lives. Thank you, Father, for hearing. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. May be seated. This morning, as we begin the workers' retreat, the message that you can find in your program outline is the cause and cause of building Christian conviction. The cause and the cause of building Christian conviction. When you talk about conviction, conviction is a strong persuasion in an opinion or belief. Strong persuasion that cannot be swept away, that cannot be removed. Strong persuasion that is stamped upon your heart, and that is no circumstance, and that is no situation, and that is nothing that is happening around that can remove that conviction, that can remove that persuasion. You know why you are doing what you are doing? It's an experience. It's an encounter. Is something that actually happened to you and you see with your two eyes and it's registered in your heart and that carries you on. And when there are questions on the way, and when there are doubts on the way, and when there are difficulties on the way, you always refer to that point in time when you started and when you began with the Lord. You are so sure, and there's nobody that can convince you otherwise of what your eyes have seen. Peter said, we cannot but see the thing which we have seen and which we have heard. Even in the face of threatening, in the face of persecution, that conviction carries you to the very end. So this morning, the Lord is calling you and I to building Christian conviction. You start it. And as you go along, you build that conviction and it makes it very strong, whereby you are able to journey to the very end. I pray that that will be your Lord in Jesus' name. Jesus Christ said in this last day that the love of many will wax cold. Those whose love will wax cold are the people who had no basis
Those who love will what school are the people who have no definite and specific beginning. And then he said that many will backslide. I pray you will not be one of the many. But he said there are some people who will endure to the end. I pray you will endure to the end. What makes you to endure to the end is the conviction. What makes you to endure to the last time, to the moment of rewarding of reward, is a conviction that is established in your heart. In Galatians chapter 6, we're going to start in John chapter 5, chapter 9. John Gospel, chapter 9. We find the story of a man there. Actually, we're going to dwell a little more on that particular passage of the scripture. This man was a poor beggar, but then he had an encounter. He had an experience that the master of law and the lawyers of law could not remove from his heart. The threatening could not remove from his heart. He had that experience, and that experience you will have here this morning. If you haven't gotten it, you will get it. And if you have gotten it already, it will be established. It says in verse 25, we're going to start from verse 25, you may actually back up later from verse 25. It says, he answered and said, whether he be sinner or no, I know not. One thing I know, that whereas I was blind, now I see. You know, this point in the life of this man, came when Pharisees, the scribes, the teachers of the law, they came at him. They said, we heard that somebody opened your eyes, and we don't believe in that man. In fact, they came to a conclusion. Just one thing, the man to discredit what has happened in his life. And he said, he has tried the glory of God unto Satan. They said that this man, we don't know about him. Let's look at verse 24. Verse 24. He said, then again. So verse 23, he said, therefore, said his parent is of age, asking. Actually, Jesus Christ had opened the eyes of this man. He was born blind. And then he was fortunate to come across the Lord Jesus Christ. And Jesus opened his eyes. And when Jesus opened his eyes, that one didn't go well with the scribe and the Pharisee, with the teachers of the law, because it was done on the Sabbath day. And so they called. They said, this man, they wanted to discredit the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ. They discovered that the more miracle he did, the more people will be following after him. And so they called the parents of this child and said, we had that because the parents of the child, they were also in the synagogue, they were in the church. And they said, we had that your child was born blind. And then now he sees. Tell us how it happened. The parents had no experience with the Lord Jesus Christ. The parents had no encounter with Christ. And so because they were members of the synagogue and they have asked, long before now, that if any will ever confess Jesus Christ, he will be thrust out of the temple. And so, they called the parents. They said, parents, come. Is it true that your child was born blind? They said, yes, our child was born blind. We know that. And they said, how come now he sees? He said, we don't see that he's not seen. They have actually heard the story. They knew about the story. But then, because they didn't want to be thrust out of the synagogue, they asked them and they said, we don't know how it happened. They heard how it happened. They said, we don't know how it happened. It's of age asking. But thank God. I say thank God. That this man had the experience, had an encounter. And that encounter, who can shake that away? Who can remove the fact that he was once blind? For more than 40 years of his life, he was blind, he couldn't see anything, and now he sees. And you want to actually rubbish that and throw that in the dustbin? He said, no. And so the Pharisees, who have read the whole Bible up to this point in time, they said that as for this man, we don't believe it because he's doing something contrary to the Sabbath day. And so we don't believe in him. He is a sinner. Give glory to God. That man said, you are saying that this man is a sinner? I don't know about that. I don't know about that. I know if he's a, whether he's a sinner or he's not a sinner, one thing I know, once I was blind, now I see. And that was his, where is truth? They threw him up and down, and they were trying to convince him otherwise, to confuse him. He said, wherefore, sorry, verse 25 again, let's read verse 23, said, then again, called they the man that was blind, and said unto him, give God a praise. You know that this man is a sinner. They were calling Jesus a sinner. And verse 25, he answered and said, whether he be sinner or no, I know not. One thing I know, whereas I was blind, now I see. They went ahead. Then said they to him again, what did he do? What did he to thee? How opened he thine eyes? Come and see a man that had conviction. Come and see a man that had an encounter, that had an experience. He told them in verse 27. Say, he answered them, I have told you already, and he did not hear. Wherefore will you hear it again? Will you also be a disciple? You know, this man already, he had already become the disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, the 10 places of those people could not make him to shut off. He had an experience, he had an encounter. And so he said that, do you also want to be a disciple? I've already told you. You don't believe, but now, do you want to be a disciple? And they reviled him. Then they reviled him and said, thou art the disciple, but we are Moses' disciples. You know, may that curse come upon you in the name of Jesus. You know, if there's any curse that somebody can mess on you and say, you will be the disciple of the Lord Jesus, right? That man didn't actually say, I will be a disciple. May that curse come upon you and your generation in the name of Jesus. He said, you are a disciple. We are Moses' disciples. They are contradicting themselves. And yet this man will not be dissuaded. This man will not be convinced otherwise. He said, we are Moses' disciples. Verse 29. We know that God spake unto Moses as for this fellow. We know not from whence he is. Imagine that. That the law, the teachers of the law, will say that they didn't know where Jesus came from. They knew that was the time they were told that somebody will be born in Bethlehem, and upon his shoulder God will lay the kingdom of the world. This they all knew, this they all are, and yet they said, we don't know where he is from. And look at the answer of the man that had conviction. This was the man that just had an encounter with Jesus just now. Just this moment. And that encounter was so strong inside of him, nothing could shake it away. Look at the way he became an apologia right away and immediately. He now told them in verse 30. Then the man answered and said unto them, wherein is the marvelous thing? He said, this is a surprising thing. You teachers of the Lord, you are saying that you don't know a man that came to open my eyes. He said, wherein is a marvelous thing? This is surprising. When is a marvelous thing? That ye know not from whence he is, and yet he has opened my eyes. Praise the Lord. Do you know where Jesus is? Do you know where he is from? Do you know who he is? Those are the questions men will ask you. That's the question your mind will sometimes ask you. That's the question Satan will sometimes ask you. From whence he is? Now, in verse, you see, I open my eyes, verse 31. Look at the confession of a man that had conviction. He said, now we know that God heareth not his sinner. But if any be a worshipper of God and does his will, he heareth. Praise the Lord. He said, we know. When we be the dregs of the society, I was a poor beggar man that was always begging at the roadside, and yet he said, how did he know? The Bible says, faith cometh not by seeing, but by what? By hearing. He was a blind man, and yet he had enough. He had a basis. And then he said, yes, we know that God heareth not a sinner. But if any man be a worshipper of God, praise the Lord. If any man be what? A worshipper of God, God will hear you. God will hear you. And then, since the world began, was it not I that any opened the eyes of one that was born blind? If this man were not of God, he could do nothing. That's it. The man had conviction. Do you have such a conviction in the name of Jesus? He wasn't afraid of the frown of those Pharisees. He had an encounter, and that is the beginning of a Christian experience with God. He asked him, say, what fear thou of him? Those whose eyes Christ has opened, no bear what to say of him. And I have great reason upon all occasions to say well of him. Conviction of the things you experience makes you to have a clear judgment of the things of God and see further into the process of divine mission than the master in Israel will ever have. There is no disputing again experience. Now, having a man act of his senses, there is no disputing against experience, against an encounter. The reason why many young ones today easily backslide, they come around and they jump up and down here. You feel this one is going to be a great minister of God, but then he has no basis, no foundation, no local standing. And so when any wind blows at him, he swerves away and then he's gone. But the man that had experience, they know where he began. You cannot argue him out of his senses. Acts of Apostles chapter 4. Verse 20. For we cannot but speak the things which we have seen and heard. That was the answer of the apostles. We cannot but speak the thing. They threatened them, we're going to actually deal with you. He said, you must not speak in this name again. They said, we cannot but speak the things which we have seen. They saw you. Praise the Lord. I pray you will see. I pray you will hear in your very heart. Not just somebody telling you, but you have an encounter, an experience with the Lord that will last you to the very end in Jesus' name. In 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 12. 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 12. Open your Bible very quickly to 2 Timothy chapter 1. 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 12. It says, for the which cause I also suffer this thing. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed. And I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. Paul said, he suffered so many things. He suffered deprivation. He suffered affliction. He suffered hunger. He suffered persecution. He suffered torment. And yet, he said, I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed. Do you know who I believe? And that's what will make you to keep going. And you will keep going in Jesus' name. Note, your mind, men and mammon, will ask you this question. Throughout your Christian race, what fear thou of him? The only thing that keeps you going is the conviction that you have established in Christ. The lack of conviction has produced a lot of fickle-minded Christians. Fickle-minded believers in all ages. They feel that grace flows in the vein. No, grace doesn't flow in the vein, but sin do. Some of us, many young people of this day, my parents are Christians. They came born again. And that automatically makes me a Christian. And so, they become a Christian. From children's church to youth church, and then they are now on campus. No moment of an encounter with the Lord. I pray that will change your life in Jesus' name. No moment of having experience with the Lord. They said that we all started together. We have been in this church for a long time. If we move, I have been in this church before the pastor because I was born in the church. That's not you. That's not what makes you to go to the very end. You must have the beginning. You must have a certain point. They are unstable. Those people are very much unstable. Anything that comes around changes them. The Bible says the world changes and with the loss thereof. And so the people who have no basis, who have no conviction, changes with the time of the world. They change with where the world changes, but you will not change in Jesus' name. They are like Reuben in Genesis chapter 49. Genesis chapter 49. They are like Reuben, who have no basis. He has the right to the inheritance, and yet he lost it because of his instability, because he had no conviction, he had no regard for God, and so he couldn't win the prize. In Genesis chapter 49, verse 3, say, Reuben, thou art my firstborn, my man, and the beginning of my strength, the excellency of dignity, and the excellency of power. Look at the qualification of the man. Look at what God has in store for a man. Look at all the packages that were installed for this man. And yet, you see, he lost that because he had no conviction. He had no backbone. He had no beginning with God. He said he was the beginning of his strength, the excellency of dignity, and the excellency of power. Unstable as water, thou shalt not excel. That will not be your lot in Jesus' name. That man never excelled all his life. His generation also did not excel because they are always defeated. They were to go to the promised land. That was where God promised them, Canaan land. They saw something better. What they felt is better. They saw something easier that could easily be possessed. And so they settled for that one. Very much unstable, no conviction. Conviction is born out of a personal encounter with God. We are not born into it, but we experience it. It does not grow. It does grow as we feed it with the word of God and constant remembrance of the place of our first encounter with the Lord. And as you go through the scripture, you will see that men who made man in the sand of time were men that had experience with God, and upon that experience build their unchanging conviction. I like to tell you of a man, Talman. Tamas had a conviction, though in the negative side. And that conviction he had, that man was an abject forever. Everybody rejected him the world over. He had no place of acceptance. In fact, not in his lifetime, his doctrine was not accepted. And yet that man, in fact, was told he was staying in one room apartment. He had a broken home. And yet, he had a conviction. And that conviction was always driving him. This man was a scholar. He had master's degree. I can't remember now if he had a PhD. And yet that man was staying in one room apartment. And in whatever work he could do, he would do that, and he would use that to buy books, and to also write, and to print his error all around. He had conviction. And something that surprised me was that this man, they asked him the question, that if he ever came back to the world again, what will he choose to do? He said, if he ever had any chance to come back into the world again, he will still do what he's doing now, even though he was in abject poverty. He had the chances of becoming a lecturer. He had the chance of becoming a scholar in the university, and yet he chose a career. He chose something he believed in, and then that one, he couldn't take it out of him. That was the negative side, and yet that man held on to his condition. And eventually, after that man was gone, that thing, the doctrine, actually affected most parts of the world. Some other people are still in the bondage of his conviction, the bondage of his error until now. I pray God will give you conviction in Jesus' name. And we look at 3 points in the message. Point number one, the cause and the exhortation to build Christian conviction. The cause and the exhortation to building Christian conviction. Then number two, the menace and the rottenness of a life without Christian conviction. The menace. And the rottenness of a life without Christian conviction. The last point, the cause and the reward of building Christian conviction. Point number one, the cause and the exhortation to building Christian conviction. In Genesis chapter 12, the cause and exhortation to building Christian conviction. Genesis chapter 12, verse 1. Now, the Lord has said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country, and from thy kingdom, and from thy father's house, unto a land that I will show thee. before now, Abraham and his household and his family, they were actually idolatrous nations. They were worshipping idols. They didn't know the God of heaven. And so God, wanting to establish a covenant with Abraham, called him. And he told him to leave where he was and to go to a place that he will show him, calling him to a separation, calling him to a walk with him. He said, leave thy father's house and go to a place I will show you. Abraham had an encounter with God. He heard the voice of God. And then he actually yielded and responded to the voice of God that called him out of his idolatrous nation. And then he left. And while he was going, another man following, that was Lord. No condition, no experience, no encounter. You know what ended the life of that man? Because he was not spoken to. He didn't take time to hear from God directly himself. It was his follow man. Called to deal. An exhortation to give him, Christian conviction. You should be called. Have you heard the voice of God that calls you? Out of your sin. Out of yourself. I have heard his voice. Jesus Christ said, come unto me, all ye that labor. Have you ever at any time felt the labor, the burden of your sin? And then under the every weight of your sin, you cry out to God and say, God have mercy on me. Has that ever happened to you? And if that's not happened to you, why don't you allow that in your life this morning? And invite him. And have this experience that Abraham had. You know what? Abraham had that call. That he was to go to a place. You know, he didn't eventually inherit that thing. He didn't get to that land because his seed were eventually to inherit the land. In fact, the land was not inherited until more than 500 years that it was called. But you see, it was sustained by the encounter. It was sustained by the call. It was sustained. In fact, when his son was to marry, and then Eliezer, he was giving Eliezer a child. He said, Eliezer, go to that place, go and bring a woman for my child. But see that you don't take my child back to that place. Praise the Lord. I thought you won't go back to the world. That is, if you have an experience with the Lord, that's what was sustaining. He had the problem of barrenness for more than 25 years. You know what sustained him all through? The starting point. The condition he had with God. He passed through many, many countries. He saw idolatry. He saw the worship of man. He saw the worship of the things of this world. You know, you remember the time when Sodom and Gomorrah were fighting battle and he had to go and fight for them. And then the bounties of the world. And then the king of Sodom said, carry all these things. He said, I lift up my hand unto God that I will never take anything that belongs to you. You know, what sustained him through that time was the conviction. What the experience he had was the beginning. And so this morning I'd like to call you to a solemn assembly. I'd like to actually call you to go back and see, did you have a beginning with God? Was there any definite encounter that you had that you can point to and say, this was the place where I met with God? If that hasn't happened to you, I'm not saying you remember a day, but could be you remember a change, a moment of change, a moment of transformation, a moment when you knelt down and you prayed and the Lord came into your heart and I was a change. If that hasn't happened, I'd like to tell you, gloomy though, that you will not laugh, but you will laugh in Jesus' name. You will get to the head in Jesus' name. Because you are still going to see a lot of changes. Jesus said it. He said, many will have their love washed and will go back. But those who continue to the end, who are the people that continue to the end? The people who are called to building Christian conviction. In Ephesians chapter 4, Ephesians chapter 4, open very quickly to Ephesians chapter 4, building. An exhortation to building Christian conviction. In Ephesians chapter 4, I'm reading verse 11. He says, and he gave some apostles, and some prophets, and some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers, for the perfecting of things, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. So we all come to the unity of faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we henceforth be no more children, we will no longer be children, tossed to and fro and carry about with every wind of doctrine, by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness whereby they lie in wait to deceive. God is calling you. He has given you pastors. He has given you leaders. He has given you His word. And all of this God has packaged so that it can become strong, so that it can have become, you can have basis. You can have the beginning. You can always refer to. He said so that you will not be tossed to and fro. God said there are many things that will toss you to and fro. There are many things that want to shake you and see if you have substance, if you have reason to actually live and call upon the name of the Lord in Deuteronomy chapter 3, Deuteronomy chapter 13. Deuteronomy chapter 13. God said, sometimes He comes to test you. He comes to look at what you say you are carrying, because false prophets will be all around. False teachers will be all around. In Deuteronomy chapter 13, verse 1, it says, if there arise among you a prophet or a dreamer of dreams, and give thee a sign or a wonder, and a sign or the wonder come to pass, wherefore he spake unto thee, saying, let us go after other gods, that which thou not know, and let us serve them, that thou shalt not hearken unto the word of that prophet or that dreamer of dreams. For the Lord your God proveth you to know whether ye love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. God is saying that sometimes you will see workers of miracles, workers of wonders all around. And then you know that this person who is saying is working miracle, he has no substance, he has no encounter with the Lord, he has two wives, he tells lies, and then sometimes he moves you away from the reality of the gospel. And then you say, come to this guy. So you say, this man, if you are not of God, you know you are not like that poor beggar. That beggar can sever between the right and the wrong. You know, and this man also is working miracle. And if he is not of God, he will not be working miracle. There you are. He will not be working miracle. And then he says, that come along with us. And you go along with that man. Or you go along with that teaching. And the teaching is teaching you things that are contrary to the word of God. The teaching is taking you back into Egypt. The teaching is making you to be one of the Canaanites. And then you are worshipping idols. God said, sometimes He allowed that so that He can prove what you are made of. He can prove that how strong you are. He says in verse 4, ye shall walk after the Lord your God, and fear ye, and keep His commandments, and obey His voice, and ye shall serve Him and cleave unto Him. God is saying, He's calling you to having conviction. That whatever is happening around, whatever you can see, that you will not allow that to swag you, to save you away, and to make you to begin to consider dropping your conviction. You know, while on this campus, I was staying in Sport Hall. That time, the Sport Hall used to be hostel. And then there was this name of a new doctrine that came. I wouldn't know now if it was Kenneth Angie. He also supported it. Because I read this act. And then, it was a new way. They call it love in the spirit. How many of you heard that before? Oh, you didn't hear that? You're still very, very young. They call it love in the spirit. And then I'll be in the spot all in my room there. I'll be hearing the lady and the man in the depth of the night. The lady will be smiling, will be crying, laughing. What kind of laughter is that one? You are in the man, you are doing prayer, and then you start laughing, and you are laughing in the spirit. Loving in the spirit. Loving in the spirit. Have you heard anything called loving in the spirit? No. So many of you didn't hear. That is because the thing didn't come from God. And so eventually, it fizzled out. No laughing in the spirit again. But if those of us who actually know the Bible, who know the word of God, we didn't join them. We didn't join them in that kind of evil. And so we remain where we are. And then after the wind of that doctrine has blown away, they came back to meet us where we are. That is a man that has conviction. That is established in Christ Jesus is not easily swept away. In Jeremiah chapter 15. Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 15. See, then thus hear the Lord. Stand ye in the way and see, and ask for the old path. Where is the good way? Praise the Lord. God is saying, stand in the way. Many ways. Many ways. There's gone to the old path, many paths. But among those paths, there is but one. And that's what God is calling you to. He said, ask for the old path. Where is the good way? And walk therein. And you shall find rest for your soul. But you say, we will not walk there. That was the signal of Israel there. That's not your reply. Is that your response? God is calling you, my brother and sister. Say, come. Come to the right path. Come to the old way. Ask for the way. Know it yourself. Not that somebody told you. Not that somebody gave you the advice. But you know it yourself. It is resolute in your own mind. And then you walk in it. And God said, the end of that road is always peace. It's always rest. Because you are heading to the right destination. You're not going the way of hell. They ask for the old path and then walk in it. And God is also calling you, brothers and sisters, to be like Daniel in Babylon. In their country, they are backsliding. But that boy and some of his friends whom he influenced, they knew the God of heaven. Even though every other person had gone into idolatry, they knew the God of heaven. And then even in a strange land, in Daniel chapter 1, verse 8, for Daniel proposed in his heart. God is calling you to propose a purposeful heart. A heart that is condemned of God, even in Babylon. You want to say it was only Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego that was in Babylon among the Jews? No. Many other people were there. Many other Jews were there. But this one, they had experience. They had an encounter. Their parents were not there. And yet they knew there were things to be done and there were things not to be done. I pray you'll be one of such. You know, I'm always challenged by a young boy. I mean a man. Great man of God. That was Moses. He was in his mother's house. After 3 months, he was put in the river. And then the queen of the land, or the daughter of Pharaoh, came. And then he saw him. And then it was his mother again. That was the way God arranged it. His mother carried Moses. He said that woman gave the boy to his mother so that until he's weaned, that is, until he can now eat good food, he can run around himself. Let's put that just 6 years. That this boy stayed with his mother for how many years? He couldn't have stayed with her, but have stayed because until he was weaned, he returned to the palace. But you know, the teaching, the conviction, this boy built over the period of these 6 years. The stay in the palace of Pharaoh, the bounty, the prospect of that place for 44 years will not erase the conviction that established just for 6 years. How do I know that? In Hebrews chapter 11. And that's what God is calling you to this morning, to build a condition that will last to the very end. Hebrews chapter 11. And I'm going to read to you in verse 23. Say, by faith, Moses, when he was born, was he 3 months of his parents, because he saw he was a proper child, and they were not afraid of the king's commandments. By faith, Moses himself, That same thing was transferred to him. Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's what?
Daughter.
6 years. When he was come to years, you know the prospect of being called the son of Pharaoh's daughter? That was, he was an heir to the throne. In fact, history told us that that daughter was only child the incumbent Pharaoh was having. He had no son. And that daughter again had no child. The one she was trying to claim was Moses. And Moses was well indoctrinated, so to say. Moses was well informed to know enough that the bounty, the prospect, and the treasure of the king's palace should not change its conviction that he has built over the period of 6 years. Now in verse 25, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God that enjoy the pleasure of seeing Paul in mortal season. Verse 23. Esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasure in Egypt, for he has prepared for the recompense of the reward. Can you see how Moses made matter? He put on this side the reproaches of Christ, joining his people with a static conviction. And then he put on this other side the treasure of Egypt, the bounties of Egypt, the prospect he had to the throne. He put on this other side of the scale. And yet, in his own mind, in his refined, sanctified mind, the reproaches of Christ overweighed the treasure of Egypt. What brought about that? It was conviction. It was an established experience and encounter. And that's what God is calling you to today. You have it in Jesus' name. Conviction is born out of a personal encounter with God. And then you have that in your heart and from this moment in Jesus' name. And you will not allow the things of this world to save you out of the way in Jesus' name. Now, the new birth experience is very, very essential. Like it was in Paul Apostle had an encounter. The encounter he was always referring to. He was always referring to, even in the presence of, intense persecution, he knew where he met God. And God is calling you to have an encounter with him. It is the encounter that gives birth conviction, that makes you go, make your going to continue until the very end. And it is that makes it possible at a time of tribulation and affliction that you have an encounter with God. Job has a problem. You have difficult situations, he had tribulation, he had affliction. But in Job chapter 13, verse 15, it says that though he's living, yet I'll do what? You know, it's the conditions that make you to trust in a slain God. Job said, though he's slain. So that was his own perception at that time. He said it was God that was slain, though God allowed the slain. He said, though he's slain, yet I'll do what? I know him more than that. I know the end will eventually bring me good. So I'll keep trusting him. It is conviction that makes you to continue in time of persecution. Acts of Apostles chapter 5, verse 40 and 41. The disciples were beaten. These were old people, family people. More than 40 years, some of them. And then they beat them very well. And having beaten them, they went back, they were rejoicing. Do you know it was conviction that made that possible? It was conviction that made the three evil children to say, Pharaoh, Nebuchadnezzar, he said, we don't care. He said, if you don't bow to this my idol, if you hear the music and all those music, and then you hear those music and you don't do anything, you don't bow down to my idol, then you be cast into a burning fiery furnace immediately. And those people, praise the Lord, may you have such a conviction with God. May you have such an established encounter with God. You know, just this week, about 2 or 3 days ago, I was doing an experiment in lab, and then I put on the furnace, mobile furnace, and then I set it at 500. We didn't set it very well. The thing went beyond 1,000 degrees Celsius. And when I saw that, you know, even the crucible that can hardly be melted was melted at that degree. And that one made me to remember what these people went through. It was a burning furnace already. And then they said they will heat it 7 times more. Let's assume when they say something is a furnace, you don't make a furnace anything that is lower than 100 is not a furnace. Anything that is lower than 200 is not a furnace because it cannot actually burn to ashes. Maybe 500. Then they now said you multiply it 7 times. Think about that. That's 3,500 degrees Celsius. And those people, they look at that and they say, my friend, we don't care. And he said that, you know what? God may not deliver. He may choose not to deliver or praise the Lord. You know, sometimes that conviction that you are not even looking for the deliverer. You say, God, even though you don't deliver me in this, I'll follow you. I'll keep trusting you. I may be the only one. He said, King Nebuchadnezzar, Marquis, we don't care. People look at Nebuchadnezzar, even if his head alone was threatening. Chocolate of the furnace of fire. Chocolate of multiplying 7 times. It's easy. You can't look at those people who are taking demons, who are swallowed demons. You can't look them to the face. You say, leave, O King. Oh, we don't care. Our God, whom we serve, will do what? Will deliver us. And if he chooses not to deliver us, no. Be known of you, O King. You will not bow to your idols. You need to be respectful. Those are men who have conviction. They are young men like you. They are young men like myself. And yet, they established a conviction in God. In fact, it came when they were supposed to be eating food, it was their right to eat the food. Brothers and sisters, it's your right to come to the university. And your right to be educated. And don't allow the education or what have you to make you change your conviction. And so, they said, even though it was our right to eat the food, shouldn't a man eat? But they remember the word of God and say, a man shall not live by what? By bread alone. But by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. They told just Paul, just beans. They were eating beans alone. And then, that was sustaining them more and more. And that's what brought them to the long life. I pray your conviction will bring you to the long life. You will be established in Christ in Jesus' name. It is conviction that makes you to stand in a time of mass backsliding in the Christendom. Mass backsliding. Mass backsliding. People just going away. The Bible says in 1 Timothy chapter 4, it says that many will depart from the faith. Many. Why is it many? Out of 10. Many of the 10 bottles were broken. Is it just talking about 2? 3? It's going beyond 5. Many will go after the conviction tree. But you see, it's a condition that makes you to stand when every other person is falling. By the way, in Ezekiel chapter 4, Ezekiel chapter 44, Ezekiel chapter 44, open very quickly to Ezekiel chapter 44, and I'm reading verse 10. Ezekiel chapter 44, verse 10, and the Levites that are gone away far from me, when Israel went astray, which went astray away from after their idol, they shall even bear their iniquity. Verse 12. Because they ministered unto them before the idol, and caused the house of Israel to fall into iniquity. Therefore I have lifted up my hand against them, fear the Lord God, and they shall bear their iniquity. Verse 14. You know, while they were backsliding, we had a set of priests that said, you have conviction in Jesus' name. In verse 14 says, but I will make them, verse 15, but the priest, the Levite, the son of Zadok, that kept the charge of my sanctuary, when the children of Israel went astray from me, they shall come near to me, to minister unto me, and they shall stand before me to offer unto me the fat and the blood, fear the Lord. When other people were backsliding, the majority of the priests followed through, and then they went with them. These people said, we know the God whom we have believed, and will never be swept away. They didn't go with them. What about the children of Rechab, the Rechabite. The prince, the prophet of the nation, took a bottle of wine, and then he didn't take them to the dear palace in a secret place. He brought them to the temple. But these young people had built a congregation for what their father told them, that you must not do what? You must not drink wine. And the prophet said, "Ah, you have seen to drink wine, and also you must drink wine, please." And he said, "You will not drink wine. You will not drink wine. The wine of corruption, you will not drink it in Jesus' name." How do you establish a condition? How do you establish where you stand? And whatever is happening around cannot change that. You are there and you are always there. You will be there in Jesus' name. Be like your God. You say, "I am God, I change it now." Many of us, we have what people say now, when they say this one, even in our church, when they say this is where we are going, everybody follows through. And then you are going, you don't actually find out. Is that from the Bible, from the scripture, from the word of God? And then when it is not from the word of God, you say, "No, I cannot do it. I cannot do it, and you will not do that." What this is wrong in Jesus' name. And also in a time of prayer, in a time of great doubt and confusion, it is a condition that makes you go. John the Baptist was arrested. He was a foreigner of the Lord Jesus. He had proclaimed Jesus. He had seen Jesus himself. And many of his disciples had left him and followed Jesus. And he was in tribulation. He was in affliction. He was incarcerated. And he was put in prison, awaiting judgment. And then he was in doubt. If this Jesus is the one we call the Messiah, and I came to proclaim him, I came to show him to Israel, and see, I'm in trouble now, and he didn't come and deliver me. Sometimes God will choose not to deliver you. You know, when your work is done, when your work is what? When your work is done, there's nothing else you're waiting for. God may just have created you, have brought you into the world just for a purpose. And when you fulfill that purpose, please leave the stage. Do what? Do what? And the process of leaving the stage, God is the one that has the prerogative of how you leave the stage. But if you want to continue, then you must humble. One man of God said, "There are 12 hours in the day where you must walk. And if the man walks within that 12 hours, he will not stumble." That's what Jesus said. And then, if you walk in the night of the ministry, you will stumble. You won't stumble in Jesus' name. And so John the Baptist had finished his work because he had 12 hours to walk. And then, the night of his ministry, he still wanted to come out and be walking. If he had come out of that prison, he would eventually be saved. Jesus Christ would go and tell him, I do this miracle. I could get him out of that place without opening the door at all. Didn't he do it for the apostle? Without opening the door at all, but his ministry was finished. And so he was ready to go. So in a time of doubt and confusion, that's what keeps you going. In a time of disappointment and bereavement, that's also what keeps you going. You know, there's a brother here, he finished about a year or so ago. They were all Christians. The father, the mother, everybody. You don't give a testimony here, maybe if you can remember now. They were in the house, and then fire broke out. It was only me and another brother, perhaps one was not even in the house, that escaped. Every other person in the house got burned. That boy didn't leave the church. He said they were, I what he even said, if I can remember now, he said they were about preparing for morning devotion. And then maybe they had petrol somewhere, they wanted to put petrol That was what happened. And then everybody got burned. That brother stopped the Lord here, and he didn't backslide. You won't backslide in Jesus' name. In time of want and wealth, it is condition that keeps you going. You will go to the end in Jesus' name. Point number two, the menace and rottenness of a life without Christian conviction. The menace and the rottenness of a life without Christian conviction. I read to you in Genesis chapter 12 about this man, Abraham, as God called him. And as God called him, he had the experience, he had an encounter, he had the beginning, he had where he could always refer to. And so that sustained him to the very end. But the man followed him. His name, Lot, in verse 4 of Genesis chapter 12. So Abraham departed, as the Lord has spoken unto him. And Lot went with him. Lot went with him. And so Lot didn't hear where God said Abraham would eventually inherit. And then, eventually, there was a problem between his kinsman and that of Abraham. And then Abraham gave him a choice. He said, choose where you want to go to. And then this man, because he had no message from God, he had no beginning with God, he had no conviction, then he looked towards Sodom and Gomorrah. And that's why those people who don't have conviction, they always look towards Sodom. Their spiritual mind, their spiritual eyes see the temporal, see the present. And he didn't know that Sodom and Gomorrah were marked down for destruction. All he had, his enslaved, everything that he threw to Sodom and Gomorrah eventually perished here. A man that had no conviction, what takes him to say, Edmund, this man, I followed him because he had the voice of God. And I've also had a long time with him. He will not pass. If you can't pass us, not Edmund parted him and eventually he lost his enslaved. Because he had no conviction, he had nowhere he was going, and so eventually he missed it. In Ruth chapter 1, the meanness and the rottenness of a life that had no conviction. Of a life that had no conviction. Ruth chapter 1, verse 14. He says, and they lifted up their voice and wept again, and Orpah, his mother-in-law, and Ruth clave unto her. These two had made a confession. They both said, we will return together with you in Bethel. And they said unto her, surely we will return with thee unto thy people. What is the basis of returning? Why are you returning with her? Ruth had a basis. Ruth had a reason. And the reason was rooted in God. He said, where you serve, where you die, I will die. Where you are buried, I will be buried, because I believe in the God you are serving. Even though that same God has killed your husband, so to say, your two sons that we married have also died. But that young lady had an encounter. She had an experience with God. But Orpah didn't have. All this while she was seen with Naomi, no experience. All this while she was saying with that woman, no encounter. I pray that will not be your Lord. You know that some people, young people there, they have been in the church since they were born. They have been coming to church all this while, but no experience. No encounter. No encounter. Nothing. And so, they will be like Orpah. Because there is going to be a moment of decision. And that moment of decision, they will make a wrong shape because no basis. On what basis are you going to make the decision that will put you into trouble? You know, Naomi told them, if you go with me now, my people don't just marry anyhow. They can't marry the heading. That woman said, it's not us that I'm looking for. If I give, I can, myself, I know that my children came to marry you. Now, if I can give birth today, maybe she has even passed menopause. She cannot give birth today. Who will marry a good woman? And then, if I can give birth today and have it, are you going to wait for those children until they are grown before you marry them? Who said in our own mind that that's not my focus? That's not what I'm looking for in you. I'm looking for your God. I'm looking for that God that is the God of Israel, the everlasting God. And so, when there was a moment of decision, they all said, surely we will go with you. How many of you have said, surely we will go? There was a time we were in a particular meeting, in the meetings of leaders. You know, when you see your demeanor, your way of doing things, sometimes I wait. Because by God's grace, I had an encounter. And so, when you speak, I know sometimes if you're preaching, you have substance, if you don't have substance. This man of God said, oh yeah, this one. But something within me told me that this man is not serious. And in that meeting, I wasn't moved. I don't just get moved by the other bosom. The man said, he preached in a great meeting of great leaders in deeper life. But something told me that this man is not serious. He said, if you know everybody now carry your Bible, put it on your head, and if your Bible is somewhere on the top there, and then you have to go and meet him, and then you have to climb, and then all this, he said all those things. You know what? Every other person was bowing down, and they were just weeping, and they thought that somebody had spoken, but something told me this man is not serious. Do you know after 2 years, that man left deeper life? Great man. Overseer. Big one. What I'm saying is that have substance. Have something. And you know, some other people who don't have substance also followed him. And they followed him. Many of them in Lagos, they followed him. And eventually, he was head of the church. Everybody, why that church? Do you know that church now has gone down? Do you hear it again? Some of you may know what I'm talking about. You don't hear that thing again because it wasn't founded on a solid rock. And those who followed him, many of them lost their lives. They lost salvation. They lost heaven. They don't even know how to come back to God again. Because you see somebody who just bamboozled you, somebody who has no substance. And you see, the Bible says the deep calleth for what? The deep. It is when you are deep yourself, you're able to sense. You have a sensor. A sensor that says, is there any substance of spirituality in such a man? A young man, sister, hear me, calls you, unless he's still now, he's talking from 1 hour. Is he talking to his sister? And I go sensor inside him that senses the fact that this man has no substance. And then the Bible says, walk away from the man when you see that there's no any knowledge, no wisdom in him. So you say, my brother, it's not commonly that a man will sit with a sister and keep talking to that sister for the next 1 hour, 2 hours. What are you saying? What do you say with a woman? John Wesley said, and I quote, speak sparingly with a woman and let your word be few with a sister. Those are men of substance. Those are men who actually don't need to the very end. And then you see that man, there is no sensor in you. That tells you yourself you are rotting. You don't have a basis. And somebody is calling you. It's who you hear over and over again that don't call in the night. And somebody will call you in the night, a sister. Then say, brother, what's the matter with you? You are bastarding. Don't ever call me again. That's the sister that has substance. There was a time I just saw a thesis of a letter. That was 1992 or 93. And then that piece of letter, I just gather it together. And it was the writing of a sister. She was writing to another brother. And she was lambasting that brother. Or perhaps of some demeanor. And then she wrote inside the letter. I remember now. She said, it is not, don't reply to this letter because it is not comely for a brother to write a sister. That was what she said that time. Those are men who have conviction, who know where they are going. And that's the reason why when such people marry eventually, they marry children of God. They are married what? Children of God. They don't marry. God knows how to match. If you are somebody who doesn't have substance, the one who doesn't have substance will marry the one who doesn't have substance. And the foundation of their not having substance will begin when they begin to do what the church says they shouldn't do. So, if you are a man of substance, you are able to actually gather. Ruth was a woman of substance. And then she said, mother-in-law said, and verse 14, and they lifted up their voice and wept. You know, when there was a reconciliation, make your choice, though. The woman told them, make your choice. I'm very sure what you are saying. And then, verse 14, and they lifted up their voice and wept again and offered kids and mother-in-law. But Ruth clave unto her, and she said, behold, thy sister-in-law is gone back unto her people and to her, unto her what? Unto her what? Return thou after thy sister-in-law. But Ruth said, entreat me not. That was a woman of consecration. That was a woman that had conviction. Say, entreat me not to leave thee, or to return from following after thee. For whether thou goest, I will go. And whether thou lodgest, I will lodge. Thy people shall be my people, and thy God my God. I'm not talking about us now. I just want to serve God. I didn't come to deeper life to look for boyfriend. You know, sister, there are some boys they are not born again, they are not brothers. They came to deeper life because they want to look for a sister. And then you are going to say to yourself, I didn't come to church because I want to look for a boyfriend. I came to church because I want to get to where? Heaven. I want to see Jesus when I die. That's why I came to deeper life. And that's my motivation at all times. That's what pushes me. That's what makes me to go on. I want to see Jesus when I die. And that should be your motivation. And that's going to be your motivation in Jesus' name. There are some people, they also follow Jesus. Benign. And the rottenness of a life without Christ, without Christian conviction. In John Gospel chapter 6. John Gospel chapter 6. And in verse 59. John Gospel chapter 6, verse 59. He says in verse 59, this thing said he in the synagogue, as he taught in Capernaum. Many therefore his disciples, when they heard this, said, this is an hard thing. who can hear it? These are the people who went a-cheating. They took sheep. They were looking for Jesus. And then when they saw Jesus, they said, Jesus, where are you? We have been looking for you. These are bread and butter disciples. They were called disciples of Jesus too. Are you bread and butter disciples? Brothers, I'm asking you. Sister, are you bread and butter, sister? You see, they were bread and butter disciples. So when they came, Jesus Christ said, you are not looking for me because you saw the miracle. You are looking for me because you ate the bread and you are full. Okay, sit down. I want to see that. I want to see you. And I'm going to be seeing. Praise the Lord. There won't be time of what? Seeing. I want to see. So he gave them the wrong thing. The nitty-gritty of the gospel. And when he gave them the thing, food and free, then some other people say, is it this our heart? How many of you have read the Buyan, Freaking Progress? You know, you heard about, you don't read books these days, young people. Freaking Progress. You have read Freaking Progress, I see your hands up. Please do very well. Not quite some 30%. You have not read Freaking Progress. I read that Freaking Progress, I don't know how many times. There was a man, when Christian left, the city of destruction, there was a man that followed him. I'm going to follow Mr. Christian. And then was following Mr. Christian. His name, you know, Mr. Pliable. Mr. what? Many of you are Mr. and Mrs. Pliable. When there is a slot of disposal, you go back. I said to you that there will be time of seeing. Jesus is going to see. And so there was a moment of sitting here. And when he actually preached the message, I will see the wheat from the shaft. Then he said in verse 59, this thing said he in the synagogue, as he taught in Capernaum. Many therefore of the disciples, when they had heard this, said, this is an odd thing. Who can hear it? And verse 61, when Jesus knew himself, that his disciple murmured at ease. He said unto them, does this offend you? These are the disciples. As they were murmuring. And then in verse 66, from that time, many of his words, are you such a disciple? He didn't say many of the Jews, he said many of the disciples went back and walked no more with him. There will be time of seeing. And when God comes and he sees, I pray you run of the weeds in Jesus' name. You will not deceive as shafts. Shafts don't have, they are not heavy. They are not what? They don't have weight. They deceive. Then you can winnow it. When you winnow the thing, and then you blow it, the shafts will grow. The time when of the wind of affliction, it winnows away the shafts. That's why this morning you will establish yourself in the Lord. I said you establish yourself in the Lord. In Exodus chapter 32. Exodus chapter 32. We saw a man there. That was Aaron. Aaron had no backbone. No conviction of his own. The people came to him and said, as of this Moses, you don't know what has become of him. And then they told him in verse 2 of chapter 33, and Aaron, in verse 1, he says, and when the people saw that Moses delayed to come down out of the mount, the people gathered themselves together unto Aaron and said unto him, up, make us God, which shall go before us. For as for this Moses, the man that hath brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we know not what is become of him. This man had just gone for 40 days. And then, look at it, a man that had no conviction, there was no resistance at all. He had been a follow of Moses. He had never at any time, like Joshua, built his own personal conviction and knew and know the God he was serving. In verse 3, it says, and Aaron said unto them, break off the golden earring. This man had been with Moses, I don't know for how many years now. He had been with Moses for more than 5 years or 10 years at this time. And yet that man immediately
said, break off what? Your hearing.
No rest. No, no, no. What do you mean? This man has just gone for 40 days. And then you are requesting for this kind of thing?
No backbone.
The rest thing is the demands of a life without conviction. When they come to you and say, brother, this one that you are talking about, can't you see every other person that these are the things everybody is in now? When you have conviction, you are able to tell them that I can't do that. I can't do what? I can't do that. I know the Lord whom I'm serving, and I'm serving Him still. So Aaron had no conviction, no backbone, no conviction of his own that would tell those people, Moses alone among them. Every other person backslided. Thank God we had the like of Joshua. Joshua, you couldn't worship idol during this time. No, you couldn't do anything wrong. Achan, you'd be stoned to death immediately. That was a man that, after following Moses for quite a long time, after being a disciple for a long time, he learned enough to sustain. God will always choose a man that will take his people to the promised land. God will choose you in Jesus' name. A louder amen. I pray God will choose you in Jesus' name. So, you must make up your mind that whatever is happening, you will build your own conviction and you will stand to serve the Lord in the name of Jesus. Those that they will not serve the Lord will be cut off. In John chapter 15, Jesus Christ said, those who abide in Him will actually trim and bring forth good things out of them. And then those who don't abide, then He will cut them off. You won't be cut off in Jesus' name. Then those who cannot go without conviction, they copy the world in fact and passion. They walk according to the fashion of the day, the fact of the moment. And that's what moves them all around. But without conviction, you will not be like that. He said, they bow to pressure of unbelieving parents who walk against the plan of God. They also bow that causes the lack of that's also what brings the lack of distinctiveness that we have among the believers and the unbelievers today. Then lack of conviction is what is coming alarming rate of the backsliding rate we're having now. Then it is what is also making a lot of people to deny the Lord. You won't deny God in Jesus' name. Now the last point, and the reward of building Christian conviction. In Ruth chapter 1, the cause and the reward of building strong and viral Christian conviction. In Ruth chapter 1, verse 8, and Naaman said unto her two daughters-in-law, go and return each to her parents and mother's house, and the Lord deal kindly with you, as He have dealt with the dead and with me. Verse 10. And they said unto her, surely we will return with thee unto thy people. That's it. We will return with thee unto thy people. I've already read to you, so that because of time, you see, they both said that. But then, you see, this other woman of her didn't calm the cause. That when she makes a decision, she will have to lose her people. She will have to lose the dishes, the food they normally eat in Moab, and then she will lose her friends. If she was going to actually establish a conviction that the God of heaven is the one who had made her, and then she made up her mind. Then she said in verse 16, and who said, entreat me not to lead thee, or to return from falling after thee, for whither thou goest, I will go. And whither thou lodgest, I will lodge. Thy people shall be my people, and thy God my God. Where thou diest, I will die. And there will I be buried. The Lord do so to me, and more also is us. For what? For death will pass. So will pass. You know that woman put a curse on her. That's the beginning. You say, me? To backslide? To go away? To follow the world? That day, Lord, let me die. You know, there was one time I was very young. I wasn't born again that time. And this coupon, and playing gambles or whatever. I can remember now that was as far back, 1984 or thereabouts. Then I was doing conductor. Now I told you I used to do conductor, so I'm not ashamed. I was doing conductor. Then as I did the conductor, I stole my Oga money. And then when I saw my Oga money, then I saw these people who normally make do cards.
they do. You normally see them in Lagos. You don't see them in Lagos again. They will bring three cars and say, so you can pick the rest, and then you will win. So I just said, this is who I can. How can you just rearrange three cards and I will not know the one, right one? Then I move close. I have already stolen about three naira that time. I said, this man, I will go home with 6 naira. I will go and buy good clothes. I will do Christmas. It was very close to Christmas at that time. So when I put the money down, the 1 naira, even my food money that I was supposed to eat for that afternoon, I put it. Then I did the thing. The man chopped the first one. Then I did the second one. The man chopped the second. All the money gone. You know, I used to go to church and I had a little of the fear of God. You know what I did that day? I told God, God, the day. You know, we normally do, let's bet. I will do my hand like this one, that this one. I said, the day I even do that alone, the day I do that, kill me. Kill me. That was what I said that day, that I do it again. You know how that's how these children go into gambling. You do it, I said, I'll make sure I win it, but I resolve. I said, the day I do it, God, let me die that day. I can remember now, more than 20 years ago, and I'll never do it. So what I'm saying, this woman said, let me die. Is there anything that will separate between us and you? That's the cause of building a conviction, of building a conviction and experience of your own. If there are nothing more that a person does after conversion, then Judas Iscariot will qualify for a candidate of heaven. Demons will not have lost out to the world for upon fear. There is nothing else to do. Nothing costs you anything. Judas Iscariot, you know, he was initially born again, but along the line, he lost his conviction. He lost his local standing, and so he missed it. And eventually, he lost everything. It's actually caused you a strong, a very consistent conviction. Job said, my integrity, I will hold fast. Integrity, that means my conviction. My what? My conviction. I will hold fast. Whatever, this is my body. Worm may eat it. There is something that worm cannot eat. Every other thing I have, they get lost. But there's something that will not be lost. I will hold fast to it. And that's your determination today. You determine. Make up your mind that what come may, your integrity, you hold fast. Daniel said, I have proposed in my heart. I have made up my mind. So wherever I am, I will honor God. Apostle said, we cannot but see the things which you have seen and heard. Paul said, of these things, none of these things move me. Said, none of this thing will mean, but I've resolved I will do the will of God. Persecution here and there, they even told him if you go to Jerusalem, there will be this problem. He said, none of this thing move me. Joseph said, how can I, Joseph, in Potiphar's house, say, how can I do this great wickedness and sin against my God? His father was not there, so you know. His mother was not there. His brothers were not there. In fact, what brought him to that place was because he was trying to keep a conviction at that time. And yet this man said, come and sin. He said, no, I've never been taught to do such a thing. Conviction. Even in Potiphar's house, you're able to do what? A brother said, I am coming to come and visit you during holiday. He asked him, brother, what for? What for? Visit me? During holiday. You know, that's where that unholy relationship starts from. That's where those kind of evil advances begin from. You're able to build your own conviction. That, he said, I proposed in my mind. That man said, how can I sin against God? The brother is telling you, things that are rubbish. You're able to tell him, how can I sin against God? What about Jephthah? He said, I've opened my mouth to the law. I cannot do what? I cannot go back. What about David? David said in Psalm 15, he said, he that swears to his own horse and does not, and does what? And changes not. That's it. He said, he that swears to his own horse and changes. What about Martin? Martin Luther said, here I stand. I can do no otherwise. Every other person was me, the gang up against me. He was the only one that was championing the cause. And he said, Mr. Man, you'll be for Inquisition. You'll be killed. If you are still maintaining this thing you are maintaining. He was just maintaining. He was just maintaining justification by what?
By faith.
It's not by indulgence. It's not by buying indulgence so that your sin can be forgiven. It's by faith. And he said, what do you mean? And he said, now, recant or you go. He said, here I stand. I can do no other way. What? Nothing else can make you have, make you say such a thing. But what? Conviction. On the course you are following. Talk about quote Polycarp. Polycarp said, these 85 years have I served this God. They put fire down. Lion was there. And they say, you are a whole demon already. Why do you want to destroy your life? More than 85 years now. Recount! And then we'll let you go. That man said, these 85 years have I served you. And I've never done me wrong. And I cannot deny him. How many years have you served the Lord? How many years have you been with the Lord? Can you say like this man? When there is fire, they've already set it up. And say, all that takes you, just recant. Just say, no more to Jesus. They're not even saying no more to Jesus. He's just the fashion and the fad of the world. Just the thing that I'm moving around now, it costs you nothing. If you put it on, it doesn't cost you anything. If you don't put it on, it doesn't cost you anything. If you don't join them, it doesn't cost you anything. But then you see, these are the people they put fire down. They said, Mr. Man, all it takes to avoid getting untimely dead, you just recant. That man said, no, I cannot what? I cannot. You only recant in Jesus' name. How do you build a viral Christian community? Number one, have a beginning that is real and strong. Have a beginning that is real and strong. Make sure that you have a beginning. Check today. Do I have a beginning? Have I a beginning? If you don't, then start. Then number two, follow on your conviction of a Christian truth. Follow on your conviction of a Christian truth. Then number three, choose your mentors. Choose your mentors. Look at the people. You know our pastor, Pastor W. Okumi, he had a mentor. Do you know his mentor? Answer now. Say it out to everybody. Praise the Lord. You also know his mentor. He has a mentor, not the contemporary. That mentor cannot see. Praise the Lord. He has already died. He has finished his race. He has concluded well. Then he chose him as his mentor. If you choose mentors that are giving to changes, Pastor didn't choose his mentor that can eventually change. His mentor has started there. He finished well. Then he chose his mentor. He John Wesley. You even know his mentor. Choose your mentor. Choose somebody and say, this man, he did wonderfully well for the Lord. I want to follow him. I want to follow his conviction. And that will see you through to the very end. Number four, read and study the Bible. God told this man, Joshua, he said, this book of the law, don't let it depart out of your mouth. Read it day and night, because in reading it, you shall be prosperous. You shall keep on. And that man never allowed the word of God to depart from his mouth. He was always reading it. Then he came to time when the people were divided, he said, choose you this day whom you will serve. But as for me and my house, we'll do what? We'll serve the Lord. So you see, you have chosen your mentor. You had a good beginning. He chose his mentor as Moses. And then he said, Moses didn't backslide, I will not backslide. And then he said, you may all choose to all of you. There are millions of you can choose myself, my two children, and my wife. You have chosen the will of the Lord. We will not join you. So choose your mentor. And then read and study the Bible. And take the Bible as a final authority and not the society. Take the Bible as what? The final authority. If the word of God says this, that's exactly what you follow through. Don't look at whatever other person is saying outside there. Follow the Bible. Follow the Bible. The word of God stands sure. And it has this seal that those who serve God must depart from what? From sin. From iniquity. That is seal. It cannot be changed. You know, there's a place that challenges me. Peter had an experience. Obvious experience. You also read the experience in Matthew chapter 17. Haven't you read that experience? He read the experience. He said, we saw him in the majesty of his glory. We saw those other great men of God, Moses and Elijah. We saw it. We saw the thing. And Elijah told them, we have more sure word of prophecy. What? What? More sure word of prophecy. He said, we saw that thing. But you know, this word of God is what? Maybe I should read it. Let's read it. Our time is gone, but let's read that please. So we can have the assurance. First, 2 Peter chapter 1. 2 Peter chapter 1. 2 Peter chapter 1. I'm reading from verse 16. Say, for we follow not cunningly devised fables, when we made known unto you the power and the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, who are why eyewitnesses of his what? Majesty. For it is from God the Father, honor and glory, when there came such a voice to him from the excellent glory, Jesus, my beloved Son, in whom I well pleased. For this voice which came from heaven, we had, when we were with him in the holy month, we have also, what? A more sure word of prophecy. Whereunto ye do well, that ye take heed, as unto a light that shining in the dark is, unto the day dawn, and the day star arise in the world. He said, whatever we have seen, you can even discard that. We saw it, we are telling you, but there is a more word of what? Sure of what? Somebody will come and say, I died. And then you start buying the paper. Start doing what? Buying the paper. You know, you should have conviction. I was in Lagos in the leaders program. And then you see, this man came and he published the paper. And about Baba Badari, Professor Badari and some other things. And say some other foolish thing. People started buying the paper. I say, there's no cluster in that paper. There's no what? People just buying things. Another one says, and some of you have the paper. You say, I have testimony. I have something, but also, why you get carried away with all those things? Those people who share the testimony, somebody will share the testimony and say, I was in a dark world. I was this. And that person is this. There's no change of life. It's just telling you lies. Why are you digging into the evil world? Read the Bible. That man said, whatever we are saying, we saw. Yes, we can choose to believe all. But we have more words, sure word of what? Of prophecy. That you should follow. And follow it to the end in Jesus' name. And be ready. Number 6, be ready at all times to give an answer to him that asks you. That's in 1 Peter chapter 3. Be ready at all times. Then choose your company. Do what? Choose your company. Don't just walk with any other person. Don't just make friends. You know, there was a lady here. Excuse me. She was one of the executives too. And then we say, who is your best friend? You know, our best friend was in Winner's Chapel. That's our best friend. She couldn't choose a friend among the beloved of God around here. You know, that lady didn't finish well. I was saying, how can that one be your friend? How can your best friend be in Winner's? She didn't finish well. She has a marital life from books. She was the one they write letter to and one choir master somewhere. No substance. Choir master somewhere will be writing a very foolish and immoral letter to her. Because, you see, she doesn't have a good company she's keeping. Choose your company and keep the one that will take you to heaven. Then the cost. Because you must have to pay. So actually beauty, then you must have, in the cost of giving your condition, you may have to leave thy father's kindred and thy father's house. Then sometimes you might have to lose friends because you don't need to meddle with those who are giving, excuse me, to change. You will incur the ridicule and the wrath of men. Then you might have to sometimes lose some treasure, excuse me, in the course of building your own personal conviction. Then when you do all this, are there rewards? Rewards are limitless. Ezekiel chapter 44 verse 14. I've read to you the other time. The priests of the sons of Zadok, they didn't follow the mixed multitude. The other priests followed them when they went into the idolatry.
When every other person came back, God told them, He said, you that followed your people when they were committing idolatry, you no longer serve me. You no longer trust the holy thing. You can be serving them, minister to them. They have limited ministry.
You won't have limited ministry in Jesus' name.
Those other people who followed them, who had no convictions, they eventually had limited what?
Ministry. But the sons of Zadok that didn't follow them, we don't have time because my time is short, they were given expanded ministry. You'll be given expanded ministry in Jesus' name. See, to whom much is given, much is required. And then when God gives you, then you prosper in it, then you are given larger place to inherit in Jesus' name. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, 2 Timothy chapter 4, as we round up, 2 Timothy chapter 4, and I'm reading verse 16. I mean, verse 6. Say, for I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I've fought a good fight. I've finished my course. I've kept the faith. And for that is lay all for me a crown of righteousness. Praise the Lord. The King, the righteous judge, shall give as to me, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that do what? You will love your appearing in Jesus' name. He said, it's not to me. I've finished my course. I've fought the good fight. There are battles along the way. I've finished it. You know that's why I told you, he knew when to finish his race. AD 64, we are told he was beheaded. He didn't die the normal death that many of us are wishing to die. But he knew, he said, I'm ready to be what? To be your fight. He wasn't saying, God, why are you going to allow this man to kill me? Get me out of this place. I am what? Ready. He knew when it was nice, it was good. When your vision was louded, he knew when to leave the stage. He said, I'll finish my course. May you finish your course. May you find a good fight of faith. May you endure to the very end in the name of Jesus. What about Ruth? Ruth had conviction. You know that there's another place. I couldn't read that place to you now. Boaz said that you have done better than the beginning. He says that at this latter time, your righteousness, your righteousness is even increasing. You know, some people virtue decreases. But for Ruth, it was increasing. And eventually, you know, she was the one that made the right choice. She became a ancestress of who? Our Lord Jesus. Because of that singular conviction that the God of heaven is to be. But there are no people in Israel. Was Boaz not having a wife before that time? He had children before that time. But it was the child of that woman, Obed, that eventually became the father of Jesse. And Jesse, the father of David, and can count it on and come to our Lord Jesus Christ because of that conviction and decision to follow the Lord. I'm following through. Do whatever happens all around. I'm following through. You follow him through in Jesus' name. Finally, Paul said, if I build again the thing which I've once destroyed, have made myself worse. So many of you are building again the things you have once destroyed. You have seen things are changing, you're also changing too. You are seeing that this one is being lowered down there, you're also lowering down things. Paul said, if I build again the things which I won't destroy, I made myself a transgressor. Rise up and let us pray. The cause. And the cause of building Christian conviction. We've spoken now for more than 1 hour. And you need to pray and commit yourself to the Lord. You want to last? You want to continue? Start. Start strong. Begin well. Begin well. Do you have a beginning? Have you had established a covenant, an encounter with the Lord? If that is not there, all is all chaff. You are crying all about. No substance. No substance. Nothing. Pray this morning, Lord Jesus, have your way. That man said, where are you calling a sinner? I don't know whether he is a sinner or not a sinner. One thing I know, I was once blind, now I see. Now I see. Do you see? Has your eyes been opened? Has your eyes been opened? Now I see. Now I see. Now I see. Pray and call upon the name of the Lord. Pray and call upon the name of the Lord. That man said, where are you? It's a marvelous thing. You say you don't know him, but I know him. I know him. I know him. I know him. You teachers of the Lord say you don't know him, but I know him. I may be a poor beggar. I've never seen all my life, yet I know him. I know him. And we know, and we have asked, that God heareth not a sinner, but if any man be a worshipper of God, he doth hear it. Do you have such a testimony about Jesus? Do you have such a testimony about Jesus? Have you a conviction of your own? Or anybody comes from anywhere, and then they come to you with vision, comes to you with revelation, to you with revelation, and then you are easily swept away. You are easily carried away. He will all come for the fullness of the measure of the stature of Christ. There will be no more babes, children, tossed to and fro with every wind of doctrine, with all craftiness of men, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. Are you such a fellow? Children, you are still, baby, you are no condition of your own. Now you are an heir to the promise. You are still a child, still under tutelage, ever learning and never coming to the knowledge of the truth. Are you such a one? Call upon the name of the Lord this morning. Call upon the name of the Lord this morning. View the conviction. The time. Give the condition that gives you a sensor, spiritual sensor. You are able to discern between right and good. Somebody may come to bamboozle you, but you have a spiritual sensor in your mind, in your spirit. You are able to know this one is of God, this one is not of God. Conviction is what gives you spiritual sensor, inner sensor. To censor, to know the original, to know the real, to know what is from God.